Okay. Well, hello everyone. It's nice to see everybody again. I'm Christy Wadehofer, one of the student support counselors. For those that have not met me yet or been to a speaker series before, we're so excited to have you here and to put these on for you. We've got a stacked schedule already this year, constantly more are coming week by week. If you have a topic that you would like to hear more about, I'm gonna go ahead and drop my contact information into the chat box, but please let me know because I really wanna tailor this series towards topics and speakers that feel like they would be most beneficial for you, your family, and our community. Similarly, previous presentations and handouts from today's presentation, and also we're gonna link this whole chat, the Zoom presentation, will be on our Healthy Chefs website. I will also link that down into the chat box as well so that you can bookmark that for future reference. But we are really excited to actually be partnering today with Dr. Reeves and Dr. Stewart. We actually started chatting about the speaker series back in like, I don't know, March maybe, right when COVID first kind of took off and everyone was scrambling and they were fantastic and wanting to support our community. So we were really excited to be able to still have contact with them and have them share time with us and their valuable information. So without further ado, I'm gonna go ahead and turn it over to Dr. Reeves and Dr. Stewart. They're gonna be sharing screen back and forth on speaker view. So if there's any confusion, that's what's going on as you see it popping back and forth. And I'm gonna pop back out. But without further ado, thank y'all both very much for being here with us today.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you, Christy. Thanks so much for having us. And we're really proud to be a part of this series and grateful for the opportunity. So, as Christy was saying, I'm Dr. Shanna Reeves.
Hi, I'm Dr. Monica Stewart. Shanna and I are not only coworkers, but friends, and we met, what's it been, maybe 10 years?
I think it's been about a decade.
Yeah.
I think so. Yes. And so lucky to be able to, you know, be colleagues and friends. She's actually right over there, just on the other side of this wall. But we, again, are so pleased to be here. And we know that everyone's time is really valuable. And we also are very cognizant of the fact that, you know, an hour will fly by really quickly. Because everyone's time is so valuable, I don't want to spend a ton of time going into what the research, you know, says. Please know that we have utilized a research base to put this presentation together. And then you will be provided with, as Christy was saying on the website, we'll have a handout that will have sources of information, our sources of information, as well as just recommended readings and books that we love to recommend, particularly to parents of teens. So the goal of the presentation, we want to give really brief overview, just a discussion around parenting practices that can help balance the different needs of, or not necessarily different needs, but the balance the needs of both nurturing your teen and developing independence and autonomy. You know, as the preview for the presentation said, it's kind of like teaching them to learn to ride a bike. When do you let go? When do you remove the training wheels? When do you run alongside them to, you know, help them balance and make sure they don't fall? And are there times when maybe it's best to let them fall, so to speak, so that they can learn how to bounce back up? I know, you know, Monica and I talk a lot about resilience, not only in our clients and the families we get to work with, but in our own children. Monica has the perspective of having successfully raised two young adult daughters.
That's right.
I'm still in the throes of school-age parenting, but, you know, before I was a parent and just in my training program years ago at UT, I used to tell parents it's the hardest job in the world, and I meant it with all my heart. Now, I can own it. I've got it. I can personally attest to the fact that it is, it's really hard. It's really, really hard. We actually found a funny meme that sort of speaks to this, to just bring a little bit of humor. I think Monica's going to try to share a screen and flash.
I'm gonna try, Shanna, but it's, you know, this is not a format that we use for our session. So actually, I'm not sure, but we can describe.
That's okay. If it pops up later, then great. But it's basically,
I'll do that.
Talking about how, you know, difficult parenting is, and how I think it is so very humbling too. And you know, it's one of those things that, it's a lot of times it's really fun. Honestly, a lot of times it can be discouraging. It's always exhausting. And it's very humbling. I think more than anything in my life, parenting has taught me, even coming into it armed with the knowledge of being, you know, a child clinical psychologist, an educational psychologist, you sort of are working from the ground up. And, you know, it is not just about your kids, but it's also about, we parent through what we want for them. And I mean, I know, Monica, I think we can all agree, the parents we work with and ourselves as parents, you know, don't we all want more for our kids than, you know, we want better for them, more for them. And I think sometimes it's the balance of what is that more? Is the more achievement? Is the more the Ivy League? Is it the, you know, the fancy career? Or, you know, or is it maybe, you know, I think what we want to speak to today is, how do we parent in a way that builds kids up from the inside, builds their sense of competence and belief in themselves? I can certainly say, you know, that we're all really fortunate. I think the Westlake community in particular, you know, we live in a community, and many of our families, you know, have advantages, and we acknowledge that. And, you know, I think that we're very lucky that our kids can benefit from this atmosphere of, you know, excellence and achievement. But I think it's easy to also get caught up in the game of like looking way far down the road. And will this particular situation, what will that mean for their future? And that can make it really hard to step back and, you know, as your child is developing and getting older, and approaching senior year, right? I'm sure there's some parents of seniors out there that are very much in this season of, you know, thinking about, what should I continue to do for my child, and what do I need to step back from? You know, to make sure that they have the experiences to learn to do it on their own. So I think it's important then, one of the ways that we wanted to structure this presentation is to make it where it's really applied. So looking at the research and just from years of experience, Dr. Stewart and I were able to come up with, let's kind of give some concrete guidelines on, when do you step in? When do you come in and take the handlebars, so to speak? You know, when do you kind of run alongside, watch closely, and be on standby? And when do you let go? Dr. Stewart, do you want to speak to that first piece of, you know, when do we step in? What are our absolute deal breakers, so to speak, of like, nope, I'm coming back in and I'm taking the reins back?
Sure, absolutely. I know. Since we're friends, we often talk about our own families and the challenges we have, even with our background, making decisions about what, you know, how am I going to be responsive to a need versus sort of stepping in because of my own worry and concern and really not giving my child an opportunity to show their level of independence and what they can do and be resilient. My daughters are a little bit older. They're in their first jobs, and their challenges now are different than when we were in high school and in those teenage years. But certainly, as my youngest was making her first high school schedule, I remember making the decision, which was a really hard decision, about asking her to choose one activity. So she wanted to be in band and golf. And for those parents who aren't at that stage yet, those are really time consuming activities. And I think it depends on the strengths of your own child. And my youngest daughter has a lot of great strengths, including having a high need to get things right, be very achievement oriented and do her best. But I'd say she's more challenged with trying to have some self-compassion and balance for herself. She can really just, you know, work too much and maybe not have more of the social side. So as a parent, I remember making that decision that she needed to pick one activity and not do both. And of course, that isn't what she wanted to hear from me.
Yeah,
she was, you know, but later as she got older, she did come back and it was nice that she had that conversation with me and said, Mom, I think you are absolutely right. And I had a much better high school experience by focusing on one thing that was really important to me. And that choice was hers about which activity she picked. But I knew as far as being able to focus on grades and friends and two very demanding activities that for her, that would be more stress than I thought would be helpful for her. So those, you know, it's that process of deciding when do you step in? And I remember that being a very conscious decision and deciding, oh, I really feel like this is a time when I need to be clear about what I think is best for her.
Mm-hmm. Because you knew her well and her individual sort of challenge and personality.
Right.
And knowing, you know, I think that speaks to, and hopefully we'll have time to get into a little bit of the strengths-based parenting. You know, you could acknowledge to her, look, you're committed, you know, are driven, and just thinking about the balance of can you be as committed and driven as you would put yourself, you know, the standard you would hold yourself to in these two really, you know, time intensive activities.
Right. And just managing the stress of, you know, of college applications and transitions into being a teenager and learning to be more independent. And I wanted her to be able to have resources left to have to focus on that piece, you know, her social emotional development and not just her achievements. So,
right. Yeah, no, I think that's such a good example of the things that we're talking about. And that, you know, you're pointing out something like one of the times when we do want to step in is when knowing our child or children like we do, is their health and well-being, you know, I think that's paramount, right? Mm-hmm. Is their health and well-being and their safety or the safety of others being impacted in some way by the decisions that they're making? I mean, that's, you know, an absolute definite, you know, that's your job as a parent is still to put up those guardrails and to protect.
Sure.
I also think it's important to talk about, and especially, you know, in light of the context of COVID and, you know, I think I'm finding in my work with families and teenagers that there's not quite as many opportunities for autonomy and independence. We would have in a normal world, right?
Mm-hmm. For sure.
Yeah. So I think trying to find, you know, ways to, and I've actually recommended, which is very counter to what I might normally recommend, but for certain situations, it's like maybe you do give more access to their device, their phones, because that is such a social outlet, right? I mean, it's not, you know, we are having to all sort of pivot, so to speak, you know, hearing that word, even around these kinds of issues in parenting, because you want to be able to provide enough age appropriate ways for them to socialize and to have autonomy and to even to make those social blunders and those, you know, social oversteps. Yeah, because that's how we all learn and develop as people and develop resilience, right?
It does feel like a bit of a reversal right now that I think as parents of teenagers, you have to look for additional opportunities for independence where I would say typically, you know, we're more concerned with are we giving too much and what is the right level of supervision? So
right.
I think that is a new and different challenge right now.
Right, absolutely. I've had so many teenagers, it just popped in my head, who have gotten their driver's license during all this time. And it's like, oh yeah, I got my wheels, I got my driver's license, and I have nowhere to go.
Absolutely.
It's certainly, you know, it's very interesting and does make for, you know, different concessions and considerations. I think it's also important to distinguish between what is a marked change in academic performance in progress versus one bad test score, or, you know, maybe there wasn't enough preparation involved, or some missed assignments that get in late and have points deducted. I mean, I think what we advise parents on, and when we become, you know, in an initial consultation and a parent is discussing their concerns and, you know, describing their child and their family and their values, I think the thing that concerns us that we, you know, alert to and attune to is that, you know, it's really different. They didn't want to sign up for, you know, history is their thing and just wanted to take grade level history this year. It just wasn't, you know, or if, you know, of course, if we're seeing that they're truant or they're not where they're supposed to be, and, you know, all of those things would be considered a big red flag. And you would want to, you know, I think have an honest conversation with your teen and, you know, and of course, if there's any kind of big change in like sleeping patterns or eating patterns, if you notice, you know.
So those are the times that you're thinking you really want to step in more and have increased supervision and.
Yes, increased supervision.
Involvement.
And, you know, I do know a few teenagers in my life that I love. And they may not always, you know, want to answer your questions. And, you know, I mean, there is that sort of push-pull, right? And so I think that is, it's hard to, you know, I think when you're parenting a teen, especially, you kind of have to grow a little bit of a thicker skin and to not take it so personally if they push back or if they do, you know, fail and try not to make it about your own, like you said earlier, try not to make it about our own anxiety. And instead, you know, try to really be listening, be curious.
I know, Dr. Reeves, sometimes one of the things we talk about with our clients is when things don't go exactly as we're hoping, or there's areas we need to step in more as a parent and give them more direction than we have in the past, that it's important to sort of talk about the idea of failing forward or using a growth mindset. You want to chat about that for a minute together?
Absolutely. No, absolutely. I love that that idea. And, you know, I think that the growth mindset is huge. And I've been so pleased to see just in my own kids' education how that has in many classrooms become a discussion too about, you know, that we all must, you know, try and fail, so to speak, to continue, you know, to evolve. And I think, you know, speaking from a growth mindset, one of the things that's born not only from that literature, but in the positive psychology literature and research is this idea of strengths-based parenting, which I think is really important when we're talking about the discussion around autonomy and trying and failing and resilience. So strength-based parenting would be, you know, finding what are your kids' strengths, right? What are those underlying character traits that you know will foster their independence and their ongoing development, right? Mm-hmm. So in the example you gave earlier about your daughter, which is just wonderful, I could use that again, you know, thinking about her commitment, right? And her, I guess, desire for excellence, or, you know what I mean? Just that, how she is very driven. And how that is a characteristic that will, you know, I'm sure is still with her. I'm sure you still see that, you know, even as a young adult.
Right. Yes. In fact, I would say, you and I had a conversation talking about when we're reflecting, on our parenting, especially, thinking about development of our kiddos' strengths that they already have and further developing those in order to help with the areas that maybe are more challenging. But working, I think she would say she continues to work on that life work balance now, you know. And it's still something that she strives for, but yeah, she continues to use her assets and strengths to explore that.
No, that's a wonderful point too. So yes, I mean, I think one example, and Dr. Stewart, you know, you can chime in here too with additional examples of, you know, how do we, how do you do strengths-based parenting? So an example that I was thinking about was, let's say your teen has started a club. They do everything they need to do to actually start a new club that's focused on some aspect of the environment, for example, or climate change. I absolutely can understand why, and I, as a parent, would probably, my first instinct would be like, oh, this is going to look great on your college applications, you know, like,
of course.
Yeah. But I think what would build up and what does build up that, you know, those strengths and resources is to point out what underlies that. What were the character strengths that your child showed in getting that established and getting that started? Well, they're passionate about the environment. They were committed and they had to research and follow through on the steps, and they had to, you know, communicate with a faculty sponsor and advocate for the need for the club. You know, all of those are the mm-hmm. things that will be there long after the club is dissolved or, you know, she's off.
So you're talking about really recognizing those underlying values and traits?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes, exactly. Exactly. Mm-hmm. Versus just praising that, behavior or that action or, you know, whatever it was. And I'm so proud of you for starting the club. It shows how committed you are. It shows mm-hmm. how you stuck with it, even though you had a lot going on too, you know what I mean? But you made time for this because you were committed to advocating for climate change. And I really admire that. You know, so just,
right, because that like you were saying, that child's strength of commitment is going to serve them well in many more incidents in their life. And if they recognize their own strength in times of stress, mm-hmm. they can say, oh, but I, you know, one of the things that I'm really good at is I'm really dedicated and committed and can stay with something. Mm-hmm. Is that what you're really, as far yep. as strength-based parenting, looking to happen? Is for them to generalize that and take it with them forward to other circumstances.
Right, exactly, exactly. And there is, you know, research and literature that demonstrates that children who are parented in that way, they are more, they're less likely to have, you know, issues with depression and stress because they do internalize that and it becomes their self-talk, as you're just as you're saying. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, I think we're all, you know, wanting to parent in a way that's building up their true competency, right? And building up their ability to do the right thing for themselves and for others, even after we're gone. And I think that's where that, you know, the real deep meaningful and sometimes anxiety provoking parts of parenthood can come into play. Dr. Stewart, can you talk a little bit about, we were talking earlier about looking at setbacks as information.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that's a really useful discussion.
Sure. It's related to like growth mindset or the idea of failing forward. I often talk to clients when they have a setback and they're taking it very personally and really upset and having, you know, being maybe very self-critical and worried about how others might see them during a setback, talking about using that time as just information and taking it less personally. So if something doesn't go the way as expected, if you can put yourself in a position of saying, what's the information I need about why this occurred? How can I gather that so that next time I can make adjustments, you know, for the situation? And not only is it helpful to you moving forward and actually achieving, which we all want, but it's helpful on a social emotional place because you can begin to see things as a learning experience rather than a failure, and as an opportunity for growth, which is the whole growth mindset. And I think the way you approach tasks, even tasks with risks, is differently because you can say, well, I have an opportunity to learn from what didn't go well, areas of improvement, and that those are the things I can work on, rather than internalizing it. These are the things that I didn't do well, and I feel bad about myself for that.
Yes, and I think, you know, that's, we want that for our kids. And I'm just thinking about hearing you talk about that. I feel like I do that a lot as a parent, you know, and like reflecting at the end of the day on how did I manage this, you know, conflict over homework, or how did I manage my own frustration at the end of a work day when, you know, whatever XYZ happens. Right. So I think too, like that's important for us to all remember as individuals. And, you know, I think that gets me to the point of kind of modeling some of that for our kids too, right? And coming back, like, let's say things don't go well. Let's say you do have a red flag and you're going to have to step in and take the car keys away. You've gotten some information that's one of those, you know, one of those big red flags. Then I think coming back and you know, that has the potential for conflict, and it has the potential when you're dealing with your team, you know, for it to not go well. And then to be able to come back and after your own reflection of what I could have done differently, or maybe what I could have said, or how I could have framed it, you know, coming back to your child, even your teen, and having that conversation of like, look, that is not the way I wanted that to go. I'm doing this because I love you, and I know you're not gonna, you know, be super happy about the idea of not having the car keys, but, you know, this is one of those times when I'm stepping in, you know, kind of just like you did with your daughter.
So I know you, we talked about some guidelines. Do you want to talk about some of the times that you might be more likely to step in? What are the things that you look for when you want to be more hover, so to speak, or, you know, get more involved?
I mean, I think, you know, anytime that we see, like earlier we were speaking about those marked changes in behaviors and sleeping patterns, or, you know, sometimes there is that sort of gut, you know, you sort of have a gut instinct as a parent that something is really off, but maybe you don't have evidence of anything, you know, that is as one of those red flags. But I think even just a gut instinct and some, you know, mild indicators that something might be amiss is warrants not stepping in per se, but just, you know, being a little bit more present, maybe being a little bit more curious and asking, you know, a few more questions, and, you know, just, I guess, watching more closely. And maybe even, you know, saying something to your teen of, you know, I've noticed that your friend so-and-so, you know, she was over here all the time every weekend, and I haven't seen her around at all. You know, is there anything that you would want my help with that? Or, I mean, is there, you know, do you want to talk about anything? Or, you know, and just kind of like phrasing it in that way. Not to say that you want to necessarily totally get in their business, but that might be, you know, I think when there's change in friendships too, although that is very developmentally appropriate and typical and expected, you know, it's certainly a time, because those processes can be painful for the child going through it if they are, you know, having to shift social circles and all of that. So just, you know, holding them a little closer and building them up at home, you know, with the positives that you see. So yeah, I mean, I think, you know, another indicator of when you may just want to be a little bit more monitored, you want to monitor more, might be dropping out of an activity that's been something they were really, you know, maybe excited about, and, you know, all of a sudden then they're not wanting to be a part of that anymore. So, and two, if there's a few missing assignments or there's some late assignments and that's just not like your kid, coming at it from a perspective of like, you know, hey, we all do these things and these are, you know, growth opportunities. We can figure out what went wrong or what we could do differently next time, but is everything okay? You know, is there anything that you need from me, any kind of support that I can give you that I'm not, you know, or anything that I can do to make whatever it is easier? And again, you know, trying to do that in a way that they're not intruding and being, you know, I guess overly intrusive, because if I know anything about teenagers, it's that they like their privacy. And you know, it's, they don't want to be micromanaged. I hear that so often in therapy. You know, my mom's always micromanaging me about school. You hear that as well, I'm sure.
absolutely, and experienced it as a mom too. I think sometimes that's one of the challenges of thinking about the level of appropriate supervision, and of course each kid has their own needs. I have two daughters, and I would say they were not they didn't have the same strengths as you would expect. And of course, clinically, we talk about how kids could have reasons why that level of supervision would be different. So would you adjust that in thinking about it based on some, diagnoses, whether it's ADHD or depression or something like that?
Absolutely. And that's a really good point. And that does speak to, individually tailoring our parenting, right, to mm-hmm. our different kiddos. But absolutely. And I think it also speaks to, let's say we have, your kiddo has been diagnosed with an attention deficit disorder. You may, especially freshman year or even the beginning of every school year, you may talk with your child about taking a more active role. And make it very explicit and say, yes, I am, I'm going to be monitoring things and helping you, if there's anything I can do to help you be organized or do anything else. And then, it's one of those things where I like to talk to parents about, we take cues from our kiddos too, right? And so mm-hmm. when assignments are completed on time and there's not a lot of, a lot of missing pieces, and when your kiddo is adapting and they're not staying up until 2 a.m. trying to get everything done, that's another time that I would encourage parents to step mm-hmm. in and evaluate, because, again, health and well-being is paramount, right? Mm-hmm. But sure, I think tailoring, or in your case, you mentioned a child with depression. So mm-hmm. in that situation, a change in peer group or dropping from an activity might bump to a red flag based mm-hmm. on prior experience. So I think knowing, not only your individual child and their needs, but also thinking about it from a background perspective and what you've seen before, knowing what your particular child's sort of red flags are, and they can right. be different, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
I also think I want to say quickly about what are the ways that, when are we hands off? Right? When do we allow, because one of the major tasks of adolescents is finding their identity, right? And trying to individuate in a sense and figure out how much is me, how much is this crowd that I'm in, or, how much am I trying to fit in, and what is really my passion and what is really my, core values and identity. So I like to advise parents, when it comes to hair color, even haircuts, when it comes to fashion, music taste, I think in those respects, that's really a place where it is important to, if you're going to say anything, maybe just ask some questions, be curious. Why did you pick green this month, honey, for that streak in your hair or whatever,
Right, absolutely.
Because truly, I think that it is an important sort of avenue for kids to have that opportunity to discover, themselves. And sometimes kids that are given those outlets freely, they may be less likely to choose a more destructive outlet to, try on an identity, if that makes mm-hmm. sense. So I think loosening the reins when it comes to that sort of thing. You can play this horrible music that I can't stand, this, death metal or whatever it is, but it has to be a reasonable volume after 10 p.m., right? That's a barrier.
Absolutely, right.
It's like, I don't care what you listen to, but you got to turn it down when it's 10 o'clock, mm-hmm. So yeah, I don't know. Can you think of any other ways that kids may be able to, in a healthy and a safe way, try on some of those identities
I was thinking of a couple of clients who which were really challenging for the parents to think about where that line was of mm-hmm. appropriately guiding and supervising, because their personal preference and was for some risk-taking activities. Mm-hmm. And so I think that's a really hard one in the parenting realm, and even clinically, about respecting that people's level, comfort level with risk is different. Mm-hmm. And you want to provide as healthy as an outlet as you can, because people will seek that anyway. Mm-hmm. Right. So we kind of all met and talked about that. What are some options that would be comfortable for the family and their values and meet the teen's needs, mm-hmm. for risks that were structured. And as an example, one started rock climbing, which, you know, it's like channeling that excitement that they need and want in a way that, as a parent, you might have to do some letting go if you're uncomfortable with something like that because you don't have your own experience with it. Or another one was, you know, racing dirt bikes, right? And there's potential for injury and things like that. But that particular kiddo had a strong need in his personality to have that kind of stimulation and excitement. And I think as a parent, if you're not necessarily wired the same way, that can be a hard moment of deciding what is an appropriate level of supervision, and are you comfortable with doing some letting go around a difference in personality between you and your child, and mm-hmm. and letting them meet the needs that they have.
Mm-hmm. That's a really good point. That's a great point. Absolutely. Yeah. Parenting is really hard.
it is.
It's always changing. You know what I mean? Like this strategy that works not just with one kid won't work with the other, but, you know, all along the way. Like I can imagine and keeping this, our audience in mind too, you know, what you might do for an entering freshman, mm-hmm. right? It's going to look different than what you're going to do for the entering junior, whatever it may be. You know, I think it can be, it's hard too, because I know like parents, we know a lot of stuff, right? We've been around the block a time or two. Most of us have, you know, had a good amount of formal education. We've done the studying stuff, you know, especially when it mm-hmm. comes to the academic piece. But I see it time and time again that, you know, if I'm working with a kiddo and either like doing therapy, but mixing in some executive skills coaching, I will recommend tips on organization or time management or whatever it may be. And, in talking with parents and teens together, the parent would be like, well, I've said that before.
Oh gosh. Yes.
I bought that app for them and they didn't use it, you know?
Right. Absolutely. I still use this joke, and I'm sure my daughters don't appreciate it because it's too old, but I would say I could walk up to a stranger and pay them $5 to whisper in their ear and tell them to tell you something, and you'll come home and be like, I heard the best thing today about what I should do. But I experience it now clinically with parents who tell me, oh my gosh, I've been telling him or her this, and they came and now they're doing it. I'm not sure what the magic is with using an outsider for helping you with supervision, but sometimes it has a big impact. You know,
it really does.
It can be very helpful.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Yes, absolutely. For sure. I think we've touched on, let's see. One thing that I think it's important for us to talk about, and we've been talking about it with our examples and everything else, is, mm-hmm. When you are setting limits with a teen, especially, research is pretty clear, and this has been researched since the 60s and the 70s, you know, the Baumrin parenting mm-hmm. research around authoritative versus authoritarian, right? Mm-hmm. And there's two dimensions of parenting that are looked at when we're sort of classifying parenting styles according to this model. And those two, the two dimensions are responsiveness or warmth and demandingness. And I think it's important, and Dr. Stewart, maybe you can say some about what kind of, you know, when we hear the word demandingness, mm-hmm. it doesn't necessarily, you know, I'm curious if you could speak a little bit to what are the, in the parenting world, in the parenting context, what are we talking about when we say demandingness?
All right. Like clear boundaries and appropriately high expectations, mm-hmm. You know, not, but not out of reach or.
Right, right. Mm-hmm. And the difference, I think, between having reasonable expectations and, you know, not demanding perfection and not demanding, mm-hmm. you know what I mean? Something right. else I thought about, in, you know, we all review grades, of course, right, with our kiddos. Mm-hmm. How would it be if, you know, let's say you have a junior who's taking lots of, you know, demanding subjects and, you know, there's mostly A's and then we've got a B and then we've even got a high C here. What would it be like for your child if instead of going automatically to that C and commenting on that, if we, you know, talked about, oh my goodness, like, look at that. You brought that English, your English grade was an A. You remember you worked hours on that essay. Mm-hmm. And you know how, and just again, that's again, you know, the strength-based parenting approach, but also I think, you know, it's showing that you, you have expectations. Now, how do you talk about the C, right? Mm-hmm. That's mm-hmm. where I think the rubber really meets the road. And I think it depends, don't you? I mean, I think it depends.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
A number of factors. How mm-hmm. demanding was the class? How hard did they work? How much time did they put into it? How much, you know, personal responsibility did they show in contacting the teacher and, you know, going in before school or whenever they're allowed, you know, to do tutorials or whatever it may be. It may be that as a parent, you want to really heap a lot of praise onto that C because you know how hard it was for them to achieve it and how much they had to work for it. I always like to tell kids my first C was in organic chemistry in college and I've never been prouder of a grade.
Yeah, absolutely.
I've never been prouder. I could have just, thankfully I had that perspective and it wasn't that way all throughout the semester, but by the end, by golly, I was, you know, over the moon with that C because I had worked so very hard for it.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm thinking of my own kiddos, as I was talking about my youngest who tended to be very type A, I think exactly that kind of thing. If a report card moment, really the less I said, the better. I really had to comfort because she had her own internal self-talk that was like, I should have done better. So that's not what she needed from me.
Right.
But I have my older child is more social and more oriented toward that. So I might be asking questions about what type of support she would need around an unexpected grade with regard to like organizational skills or time management, because I understood what her strengths were and what were the challenges that she continued to work on. So we reviewed those separately. They couldn't happen together. Everybody come in at the same time because they had very different needs about the level of support from me in that moment.
Right, right. Yes. And mm-hmm. it's probably, you know, your girls they were teenagers at the same time, which we should mm-hmm. probably, you know, talk about too for the audience. So they were in, you know, the very similar developmental stages in the same school that was also mm-hmm. very academically oriented and demanding. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I mean, that's a great example of how to individualize that and do those discussions separately. And a good way to show respect too for your daughter's privacy, you know, vis-a-vis.
Oh, sure.
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. So I am conscious of the time. We have got about 10-ish minutes left. I'm not sure if anybody's had any questions come through, but I think Christy was going to be monitoring that for us. And there she comes. Hi.
We have not had anyone come through in the chat yet. I imagine some of that has been because we're just engrossed in what you're saying. But certainly wanting to take an opportunity to ask parents and give them the pointed time to bring forward anything into the chat or if they feel comfortable unmuting mm-hmm. themselves. But certainly they can bring it to the chat.
Maybe cricket.
And again, I will, while we're giving some parents some time, I will just re-mention that this full recording will be on the Healthy Shops website in addition to Dr. Reeves and Stewart have also put together a handout that we'll go ahead and upload the PDF of that onto the Healthy Chefs website as well. Just with some great tips and reminders for some of this wonderful information that they shared with us. Popped up. Here we go. I came in late, so maybe I missed this. So disregard if I did. We are battling here at the house about how much COVID exposure we are having. Kind of thoughts on...
Absolutely. That's so a great question.
Really understandable argument.
Absolutely. And
she said, for example...
Oh, I'm so sorry. The audience.
No, like she asked. No, you're fine. She said, for example, my child wants to go hang out with 10 friends for the third time in a week. So I'll turn it over to y'all.
First of all, so much empathy to you, Mama, because that is such a difficult situation. And I have had lots of discussion, and I'm sure Dr. Stewart, you have as well. And, you know, in our family meetings with parents of teenagers, he points out to me that I left the house X times, and we battle about if my excursions were safer than his. Oh, that is absolutely, man, very mm-hmm. difficult. Very difficult. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think here you try to have discussions over, necessity. And if there's any way to, for him to have that need met in a manner that is more consistent with the rules that you're, and the guidelines that you're placing around, you know, the health and safety of your family and the other family members. Monica, do you have any additional thoughts?
Yeah, I think it is a hard time because as a teenager, you're sort of, as you mentioned earlier, your goal and objective is to have more and more independent experiences, and that social piece is everything. And so I think this is a very difficult time for them. So empathizing with them and talking about that. And then of course you just have that natural developmental, I don't want to use the word battle, but a challenge of independence versus safety. And this is like no other. So I also think it's kind of like we talked about early on, there are times as a parent when you really have to go back to your values as a family and say, kind of lay down the non-negotiables related to safety. Mm-hmm. And although that's hard to do and can cause, not make everyone happy and cause conflict, I think if you can articulate where you're coming from, why you feel that those safety aspects are important, not only for your teen, but your whole family and how it impacts everyone, that maybe you can find more common ground and negotiate in a way that everyone can have some of their needs met. You may not be able to meet them all, but getting your teen to understand what it is, why you're considering those safety precautions, and yes, how can you still go and socialize with friends and get your needs met socially. It's a really tough time as far as that goes.
Yeah, absolutely. That's absolutely one that's, I know, so many parents are walking that line and trying to battle that right now. And that does speak to, we're touching on the difference between the authoritarian and the authoritative parenting approaches. Authoritative parenting approach in this situation would be just everything that Monica and Dr. Stewart was just saying, which is explaining where you're coming from and empathizing. So that's where that warmth and, you're still holding the limit. I think you can hear them out and empathize with, it's really hard. I want to go to the mall too, or I want to, whatever it may be. And then, and not in a patronizing way, in a really genuine way, and then take it from that, problem solving viewpoint, I think it can be helpful to say to teenagers, well, I'm open to suggestions. I want you to be able to see your friends. If you were in my position in the middle of a global pandemic, what would you do? you know, and speaking about, it's not just, you know, at this point in time, if, especially if your kiddos have transitioned from being a remote learner to an in-person learner, it's not just about our family at this point either. You know, it's about the health and well-being of your classmates and your teachers and your bus driver. You know, I mean, it does really come down to, again, your values as a family, you know?
Yeah, I think she had mentioned the discussion about level of risk in that. And I think there's some helpful graphics, which you may already have access to, that kind of help determine the level of risk of certain activities. Oh. But that's sort of, I find it to be a helpful guideline, but it's not the end all be all, because I think in some situations you just can't fully know
your
level of risk, and the uncertainty is a really hard thing for all of us to cope with, including, you know, teens who are saying, well, how long is this going to go on? When am I going to be able to gather with my friends again? It's so fun. And, you know, I put myself at, you know, as a mom in that situation, I would be really concerned about the uncertainty about, well, what happens if you're exposed and then we expose another family member with higher risk. And then it's not only that, but how does the team feel about that situation after it occurs? And it's just really complicated, you know, but I think continuing to have open communication, like you were talking about, and negotiating together and maybe identifying what the core needs are and seeing if you can somehow meet those for each person.
Very good point. Yes, and I'm remembering the graphic that you're talking about. I think it came from the Texas Medical Association. Our medical director here had shared it with everyone, but it was very, very helpful. And again, it's not the end all be all, as you're saying, but just to have some, you know, some guidelines. And I think too, in that discussion into that point, that question, I think you use the information on how careful is your teen in, you know, in the interactions that you see? Mm-hmm. Are you constantly reminding them to wash their hands? Are you constantly saying, pull your mask up when you're out in public? Or are they pretty responsible? And do they demonstrate an understanding of, you know, the larger concerns about others and other aspects of their life, you know, not just COVID related? Excellent question. Thank you so much for submitting that.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Well, I know we're really nearing the end of the hour. You're welcome. She just says thank you. It's interactive. But nearing the end of the hour here, you know, just wanted to say that, you know, I think Dr. Stewart, I can speak for her and say that we love what we do. We do empathize so much and, you know, we live the walk, the parenting walk. We're in different
states,
but, you know, I think we can empathize, you know, really fully. And I like to bring my own humorous anecdotes to sessions and consultations. And, you know, if you're feeling stuck on a parenting dilemma, I love doing just one and done consultations. Just come see me and make an appointment and talk to me for 90 minutes and let's do some problem solving. And let's, you know, we want to make it really applied and really practical and, you know, and really meet our families where they are. So if there's any way that we can be helpful, we're right down the road from the high school. So we would love to get to work with, you know, some parents, and hopefully it works out. We can do this again sometimes. This is, we really enjoyed preparing for this and the discussion.
Absolutely. And I'll be sure to link y'all's contact information and website on the Healthy Chefs website as well. So any parents who are just thinking, you know, during this time period, they can certainly get in touch with y'all. And also there are a couple other parents who popped up in the chat, you know, just sharing about how helpful and informative this was and thanking you both for your talk.
Oh, thank you.
Oh, great. Thanks so much.
Thank you.
But on that note, really, honestly, I also, on behalf of Westlake High School, want to thank y'all for your time, giving up an hour of your afternoon on your lunch break, possibly, to be with us. So thank you so much for that. And we will definitely look forward to collaborating again in the future.
Oh, thank you, Christy.
Thank you.
Our pleasure.